biological limbs do we have amongst us?
Between us, I'd say we have 2.5. It's not bad going.
Not bad.
So I was always taught that when there's an elephant in the room, you should introduce it. And as we just said, you might have noticed that Hugh and I's limbs might not look quite like yours. Hugh, in 1982, you were involved in a mountain climbing accident. And when you were just 17 years old, you had your biological legs amputated due to tissue damage caused by frostbite. I understand that when that happened, you were dumbfounded at the technological solutions that existed for you at the time. And you went on to spend your life's work devoted to improving human and technological efficacy. I guess I want to start by asking you, how do the limbs that you and I are wearing today work? And what's your vision for the future of them? What do I have to look forward to?
Yeah, thank you for that question. Yeah, in the future, our synthetic limbs will no longer be these separate device-like mechanisms from our biology. Instead, they'll be intimately integrated into our tissues. So for example, our limbs now are attached non-invasively with a prosthetic socket. It's a cup-like socket. It's not terribly comfortable, I think you would agree.
Not all the time.
It can be terribly painful. But what we're now doing is exploring osseointegration, where a titanium shaft passes through the skin membrane into the residual bone. And then what you do is you bolt the external prosthetic robot to that titanium shaft just as it exits the skin. So it offers direct mechanical loading into the skeleton. And you can also make that shaft hollow and run wires from implants inside the body, such as electrodes, to the small microprocessors on the external robot. At our new center, the K. Lisa Yang Center for Bionics, we're also pursuing neural connections, bidirectional neural connections. We want to give the capacity of a person with amputations, such as you and I, the ability to think and directly control motors on the robotic limb, as well as to experience sensory information from the device mapped onto the nervous system. Cutaneous touch sensations, as well as proprioceptive sensations as well.
That's fascinating. And Hugh, you often talk about your work ending human limitation and disability, but there are many people, and I put myself in this category, who feel quite proud using that term because of the sense of community you get, and also some people feel that they don't have anything that needs curing or fixing. What do you say in response to that?
Yeah, so I'm working diligently, as are, you know, tens of thousands of other scientists, engineers, and clinicians around the world, to advance improved technology for individuals that are not happy. They're very unhappy with their state of experience of disability and very much want change. You know, today's technology is lacking in clinical efficacy. We're able to walk fairly well, but we have a long way to go. I still believe that bionics is in the dark ages. You know, as an example, a person that has a spinal cord injury who wants to move their paralyzed limbs cannot do so. A person with seeing impairment that wants to see with their own two eyes cannot do so. You and I, you know, I'm sure you'd like to walk across a sandy beach, as would I, and feel the sand against our prosthetic feet. Cannot yet do so because of limitations in technology. Now, if a person or a group of folks are happy with their bodies and minds, then of course, bionic reconstructions, medical procedures won't be forced upon them. Patient choice is a critical principle in today's healthcare networks, and it'll continue to be important. So again, you know, medical interventions, elective medical interventions, won't be forced on any individual. So when I say that a human being can never be broken, technology is broken, I'm wanting to transition the conversation from that of human weakness and disability to more of a conversation about human potential and strength. And I want to remind all of us that current technology is really inadequate and really needs to change. And that disability also is not inherent. It adapts, it changes when technology adapts and changes. And that one day when the technological landscape allows, every person on the planet who wants to experience a new body and a new mind will be able to do so. They'll have the right to live without a neurological or a physical condition or disability. So that's what I'm thinking about.
I couldn't agree more when we break it down between the option of choice and anything compulsory. Another thing that people sort of worry about when it comes to these state-of-the-art advanced prostheses is that they aren't accessible for everyone on the planet. People who live in poorer parts of the world might not have access if they need them. What do you think we can do to democratize this technology to all?
Yeah, the new Kaylee Sayang Center for Bionics right here at MIT, a new center. A key objective is to not only expand the science and technology of bionics, but also to increase accessibility of bionic technology in developed and developing nations. So our first initiative is to increase bionic leg production in Sierra Leone, Africa by an order of magnitude. So how are we going to do that? Our model is sustained capital, a mobile delivery mechanism, boosting infrastructure, of course, well-designed and low price point, high-functioning prosthetic components as well. So, you know, after we get a foothold in Sierra Leone, pun intended, I want to raise on the order of $100 million and expand our efforts to about 10 additional countries. And with that kind of money, we can produce about 10,000 artificial limbs every year in perpetuity.
Fascinating and very exciting. I think that most people who are aware of your work are aware of the work you do for prosthetic limbs and bionic limbs to replace lost biological ones. But I think more generally, your work encompasses human augmentation. What do you have in store for those people who don't have a disability and who have all their biological limbs intact?
Right. Yeah, in 2014, my research group at the MIT Media Lab was the first to develop an autonomous, powered leg exoskeleton that we showed augments human walking for persons with intact limbs. Since that initial success, I co-founded a company called Defy with my colleagues Luke Mooney and Jeff DeVal. Today, Defy has produced you can see it here, basically a bionic shoe that is able to augment walking and running, reduce metabolic cost, reduce muscle skeletal stress, increase jumping height, and so on. I think in 20 years, we're gonna look back and say, remember that time when shoes didn't do anything? So bionic shoes and bionic apparel is coming. So exoskeletons have a vast array of applications, so in many, many business sectors. In the future, warehouse workers will use exoskeletons. The elderly will use exoskeletons. Athletes will use exoskeletons.
So exciting. I want one.
They're quite fun.
And so is this an area that you see being almost a bigger opportunity for society and people generally, designing bionics for people who are not missing limbs?
Yeah, absolutely. Using bionics for human augmentation is a tremendous business opportunity. Bionic apparel and bionic shoes in particular, I'm very excited about. So imagine augmentative technology that protects an athlete from injury. Imagine a technology that allows a person's innate athleticism to be maintained across their lifetime. Imagine running your best marathon time at the age of 60 when you've been running marathons since the age of 18. So yes, indeed, the bionic apparel, bionics applied to athleticism is a really exciting space.
Sounds it. So the theme for today is superpowers. And I think when we talk about these powers, we have to think long-term and into the future. What's your vision for humanity and how technology can integrate?
No small question. Yeah, so in my research group here at MIT, we're pursuing a neural embodied design approach, wherein biological constructs are co-designed or co-engineered with synthetic constructs to enhance or maximize the human-machine communications, mechanical and neural communications. So we're thinking fundamentally, how do you attach wearable robots to the human body in a comfortable, safe manner? How do you attach machines to the brain? How can we build machines that the sensory information on the machine is reflected on the nervous system, where a person can feel the synthetics? And how can we have a situation of great agency, where a human being attached to that machine can think and directly affect the movement of the machine? So the value of such seamless integration, such seamless communications, is embodiment. So our devices today are fairly crude. I said earlier we're in the dark ages. We can both just pop our legs off. In fact, that's what we do when we get home. They're very powerful tools, but they're not integrated seamlessly into our cells and our tissues. So that's the future, and the value of doing that level of integration is embodiment. Our goal here at MIT and across the field is, in the future, when you ask folks like Patrick and I that have part of their body that's synthetic, what is your body, that we would actually respond and include in our body image the synthetic part. Most of the time, that doesn't happen today. I mean, I view my body, when I walk, it goes the whole way to here, but when I sit like this, you know, I only go to the biological end because I don't have that connection. My thesis is that this form of human-machine interconnection or communication that leads to embodiment will also be possible for non-anthropomorphic devices, such as wings or an additional limb. I always say that in the twilight years of this century, human morphology and dynamics, I think, will be unrecognizable from what they are today. If we're able to understand how to design constructs and embody them into the nervous system, I think the level of human expression will be so surprising and so remarkable.
And I have to ask you just finally, are we ready for that kind of comprehensive shift that
I'm
our
ready.
Brains have never experienced? Can our biology handle that?
You know, as a society, we're often very limited in how we can imagine things that we cannot yet do. And in the future, technology will be this incredible lever for our creativity and our imagination. My hope is that 50 years from now, when one walks down streets in every major city of the world, one will see this profound human diversity that's a consequence of human imagination manifested into physical form. A future world where we no longer have this social construct of a human difference from a norm, because difference will be the norm. A future where every person is unique and cherished and is fully able to express. You know, today's world, we have these narrow views of what a beautiful man is, what a beautiful woman is, what intelligence is, all these narrow social constructs. My hope is they'll be shattered, and we'll see this tremendous, glorious human diversity. Now, as a society, we cannot go in the opposite direction. We cannot use future augmentative technologies in a way, inappropriate way, that collapses human diversity and it collapses individual freedoms. What we need to do as a society is develop public policy at a rate commensurate with this ever-expanding augmentation technology. Yes, to incentivize creativity and innovation in this space, but also to mitigate unintended, nefarious uses of augmentation technology. It's not difficult for any of us to imagine a hard future of, for example, parents designing their future babies, their future offspring, or governments controlling the mood of the citizens, or many other brave new world outcomes. But I believe as a society, we have the power and the creativity to do something as wonderful as solving disability. But at the same time, thank you. One soul. At the same time, being very careful in mitigating any inappropriate uses of technology that would really disrupt what we hold dear, such as human diversity and individual freedom. So I think we'll largely get it right, and we'll finally break out of these rigid molds that we now find ourselves in.
Well, I'm very excited to see it happen. Thank you, Hugh.
Thank you. Cheers.